me leaving and me coming back to see games, which I did when I left college, to see that we had a good pedigree of guys that were here and was leaving the program in good hands, you know, trying to lay the foundation, laid the groundwork, and kept building upon that. My 2004 season year was great. I can't take nothing away from it, you know. Very proud to be a Tiger. Very proud to stand shoulder in arms with coaches and players that were here, and guys that were just hungry to be successful and want to do great things here. This is Hinesville, man. This is us, you know. We loved each other. We supported each other. We were young, 15, 16, 17 years old. But one thing that we did came together upon was football. And out there between the stripes and the white lines, it was one for all and all for one. And we bled it.
My name is Jim Walsh. I was the head football coach and athletic director at Bradwell Institute from 1993 to 2012. You know, coaches that were on my staff at that time were Coach Jim Akins, coach of secondary, Alex Hogan, coach of the outside linebackers, Jeff Miller, Emmett Watkins, Hunter Chadwick, John Wood, Aaron Mock. You know, I had a great group of guys that coached, that worked hard and helping not only just coach football, but develop young men. And that was something that, you know, has always been important to me as a head coach and still is.
My name is Jeff Miller. I coached at Bradwell Institute from 1994 to 2014. During that time, I was a defensive coordinator for probably 16 of those years while I was there. When I wasn't a defensive coordinator coaching linebackers, I was coaching the offensive line.
David had coached the offensive line at Bradwell for years under Clifford Johnson and then Ross New. Jim Akins had coached the secondary, you know, under those coaches as well. You know, in trying to create stability, I felt like, you know, keeping some of those guys from the previous staff was, and from Coach Johnson's tenure at Bradwell, was going to be pretty important. You know, I knew those guys, those two coaches kind of coached at Bradwell during the heyday of Bradwell football.
Being at Bradwell for 20 years, I coached with a lot of different guys. I came in with Jim Walsh. We came in together in 1994, so I coached with Jim for 19 years.
You know, he came with me, and he was with me the entire 19 years that I was there, for the most part, as a defense coordinator. You know, another great guy, you know, that I brought in, who had a previous head coaching experience. Dang good football coach was Emmett Watkins. He was a head coach in Augusta, and you know, he was, you know, looking for change, and you know, I was fortunate enough to put an ad out that I was looking. He responded, and you know, we were able to get him to come to Bradwell, and he brought a ton of experience with him, and in his tenure there, did a great job for me. So, you know, from that point of view with the coaching staff, I was definitely blessed. You know, we had a full-time trainer at the time, John Murat, you know, who definitely saved me time and time again, because he took a lot of the responsibilities from that side of running a program. Jim Akins and David Paul, that they were vital in the fact that they had been there through, you know, Clifford Johnson days, and the Ross knew, they kind of knew the community, which is, you know, another important aspect of coaching, is becoming familiar with the community and developing the relationships. So those guys kind of made that process real easy for me, you know, in meeting the people that I needed to meet to make sure that we could do things that we needed to make our program the best that we possibly could.
2004 season, we installed a 3-5 defense. The 3-5 was installed because it was the growing trend at the time. People were going to it because you could incorporate more tweener kids. You didn't have to have big defensive ends. We lost two big defensive end types the year before in Kareem Horton and Gary Guyton. And what it did, it allowed you to play smaller guys, five smaller, faster guys across the linebacking core. And we were fortunate enough that year to have three really nice-sized defensive linemen. On the D-line, we had one returning starter, and that was J.J. McWilliams. J.J. played nose for us. He played nose the year before. And then we had Vincent Vance that played the left defensive tackle. And Vincent didn't play much as a junior. But during the summer, he took it serious. He took the weight room serious, and he came out and he played with a little bit of swagger about himself, and he had a really good senior year. Then we had a move-in, Brian Gaucher, and he was probably the missing piece up front to make this 3-5 go. When he came in, he solidified that defensive line. When we put him in the inside technique, they demanded double teams. And so they were able, if that tackle blocked down, that guard blocked down, bring a linebacker off the edge, nobody to block him. So if we put him outside, they were so worried about Vince or Brian on the outside, it would step out, open the inside gap, linebacker blitz through. So the defensive line did a really good job of helping the linebackers look good during that year. Coach the linebackers in the 04 season, and we had five. We had five guys. We started out with our two outside guys. We called them Rover and Bandit. One was Charles Crosley. It gave Charles a chance to get on the field. He was a good athlete. He played kind of a strong safety type role the year before. So it gave him a chance to get out on the field. He had Jake Walsh at the other outside linebacker. He was a headsy football player. He did have some speed. He did a lot of good things for it. He actually picked off a pass in the Camden game where he had actually gotten beat, and he fell back in on the play and got an interception. I remember that one well. But it gave those two guys a chance to come off the edge. We could apply pressures, and we did a lot of that stuff with them that year. The three guys on the inside, we had lost Mike McCampbell the year before, and Chris Bell played behind Mike, so he got a lot of reps because Mike would cramp a lot from time to time or in the season. So Chris got in there. Chris also played some defensive end for us the year before, so he had some game experience. Mick Ramsey played a lot as a junior, so we put Mick in the middle. The Mike linebacker, he was more of a plugger. He plugged. And then I had Chris Bell and Dominique Stewart at the two stack backers over the tackles. And with the linebacker core we had that year, we were able to come after people because the three guys up front were the key to it, with Vincent Vance, J.J. McWilliams, and Brian Gaucher. Those three guys demanded double teams and got us where we could bring other pressures, and they were so worried about those three inside guys that when we brought a Dominique Stewart off the edge, they never saw it. When we brought a Chris Bell into a B gap with a Sam blow, they couldn't see it. So we would run a lot of combination stunts where we were always in a five-man front in most cases. But you didn't know which five were coming. You know the three defensive linemen were coming, but you didn't know which two out of the five linebackers was coming. So that's what they had to pick up.
Jeff Miller, he was a guy that wore a ton of hats for me at Bradwell. He was my defense coordinator, my equipment guy. He was a guy that you could give a task to, and you knew it was going to get done. I mean, he was, and Jeff was the kind of coach, he was going to make sure it was done right. So I gave him a lot of tasks, knowing that it's going to get done right. It's going to be done in a timely fashion. He might complain about doing it, but in the end, it always got done.
See, we had Marcus Singletary at one corner and Omar Stoddard at the other, and then Marlowe came in as a rotator. He rotated in when Omar got tired from playing offense all the time. And then you had Jerome at free safety. It was a good package back there. The only problem is they were all seniors. You had Francois Washington. He played some backup quarterback. He played some quarterback, but he also played in the secondary. So here again, another senior. So we were senior laden all over the field on defense. So we should have been good defensively. It was kind of the going thing at the time, but it fit our personnel that particular year really well. That's the best year we ran it, was year one, because we did have the personnel to run that defense. But you have to be strong right at the middle. Nose guard, middle linebacker, and your free safety all have to be really good football players to run the 3-5. If you're missing one in that middle, up the middle of the defense, it really becomes challenging.
You know, I mean, it was a talented, pretty talented. We weren't going to be the biggest team in the region, offensively, but, I was a guy that always believed in the triple, and in the years that we didn't have the quarterback to run the triple, we ran more of a wing T style offense.
So that was kind of the concept, but that year was a trial and error year. We trial and error everything. If something didn't work, we tried to fix it.
He's too far back still, Coach. You've got to get out there and yell at him. Come on.
So there was a lot of trial and error as we installed that. And we ran that defense for probably about three more years after that, until we graduated back to the 50.
Vince Vance moved to Hinesville in 03, moved out to Walterville, my sister and brother-in-law and nephew. I graduated from Bradwell with a class of 05. On the football team, played defensive end. I played with Chris Bell, Mick Ramsey, Brian Gaucher, Arcel McCullen, Chaz Ball, Jerome Howard, Daniel Fleming.
My name is Jarrell Crawford, nicknamed Spike, but that's what I went by. You know, high school to a lot of folks that knew me, but I'm from Hinesville, Georgia.
My name is Omar Stoddard. I played for Bradwell from 2001 to 2005. Played on both sides of the ball. Played running back and wing back when on offense, and played in the secondary, free safety, and cornerback.
I'm Jake Walsh. I went to Bradwell Institute from 2002 and graduated in 2006. I played linebacker for the 04-05 team.
This is Jeffrey McWilliams, aka JJ.
I played football at Bradwell for 4 years, but I didn't play varsity until I really didn't start playing until my junior year. So 2003 is when I actually started playing. I dressed some 2002 games.
I started out going to a parochial school in Savannah, Blessed Sacrament, from kindergarten through eighth grade. And during that time, we transitioned to Hinesville, and I can't remember the exact year it was, but it was, I want to say, around like fourth or fifth grade. But my parents didn't want to take me out of my current school. They wanted me to finish up there and then move to high school.
Grew up in most of the projects that Hinesville had to offer at the time. It was North Gate and Raintree. Spent most of my years there. Finally moved out of there. My mom and my stepdad been together. And they lived together for a while up until he passed.
But when I got to Georgia, Hinesville, Georgia, it was a cultural shock. It was a different experience because I saw people like me. And some of the people that took me in, Arthur Parker, Jared Moore, you know, invited me into their cliques and showed me around. I was appreciated to this day because, you know, made it real easy to transition. Didn't really have an accent because I could kind of speak, but I didn't know how to read and write. So I was in ESL for like two and a half years, my first years in Hinesville, Georgia. So that's my first experience coming to Hinesville, just a big culture shock.
Raised by my mom and pops in Hinesville, Vivian Gillett and Pete Gillett. I went to a middle school at Lewis Frazier Middle School. A lot of us went to school at Lewis Frazier Middle School. It was broke up between Lewis Frazier, HMS, and Snelson Golden. I was one of the kids that went to Lewis Frazier. But, you know, just talking and elaborate a little bit on how it is in Hinesville. It's DeVille.
That's it.
You know, I like to tell people, you know, it is what you make it.
You know, growing up playing middle school football and then playing high school eventually, you know, it was, you know, just fun. You know, growing up, it was all just fun. But, you know, you had to be careful because, you know, a lot of the guys that you were playing ball with, you know, a lot of those guys kind of fell off. And then, you know, a lot of those guys that didn't play ball, you know, it's kind of like your friends growing up in the neighborhoods or wherever you grew up at, you know, were kind of probably doing the wrong thing. So, you know, for me, I could have kind of went anyway. You know, I had friends that were doing the wrong things. Friends that were, you know, doing the right things. And, you know, as a kid, you grow up, you make mistakes, you make bad decisions. But I think for me, football was probably, you know, one of the best decisions I made. And probably the reason I sat out a lot of trouble growing up, you know, because I had support from the community and so many people knew me playing ball.
Without the proper guidance, you know, being in Hinesville, it's easy to stray away, you know. You know, growing up in Hinesville, it ain't a lot to do. It ain't a lot to do. You know, back then it wasn't a lot of, we didn't have social media back then. It was either, you know, you was kicking it with the fellas or, you know, chasing behind some girls.
That was kind of like a way out for a lot of the kids that was growing up in the projects. You look forward to playing those games on the weekends and those scrimmages and those jamborees coming up over there at Lone Bell Stadium in Hinesville. And rest in peace to Ernie Walthour. He used to call most of those games. And, you know, I remember just, you know, most of the guys that I played with through my years at Bradwell, I played against or with.
There's always the first game you've got circled on your calendar. And our first game was against our crosstown rivals, Liberty County High School. And this game meant, you know, in fairness, it probably meant a lot more to them than it did to us because we were better than them. Majority of the time. There's only been, prior to us being there, prior to the 04 season, I think they beat us once, right? This was more of a game where a lot of people were playing their friends they played either at Lewis Frazier, HMS, and, you know, Snelson Golden, I think, was the other middle school. And again, I went to middle school in Savannah, so I really wasn't close to a lot of those guys. But for a lot of my teammates, that was an extraordinary game. It was to go beat up their fellow friends. But for me, what was important is that was the first game of the season, and it was against our crosstown rivals. So I might have not had any friends Actually, I take that back. I did have one friend, Zach Golden, play tight end over there.
Rivalry games always against Liberty every morning. You know, every that morning we would go to Shoney's and eat breakfast because you knew we would go there. We knew we'd be some guys from Liberty County High School in there. And, you know, just to kind of get that vibe before the game. Every year we played them guys up until they stopped the game and recently started it back. So, yeah, we was every morning before we played with Liberty High School, we would definitely go to Checkers and get some breakfast. And, you know, my mom used to work there, so I get a chance to see my mom early in the morning after I left off of school. So, you know, it was pretty cool.
The Bradwell Liberty started in 94. I was part of that very first game, and we beat them 7-6. And they were senior laden. And we beat them in 94, 95, 96, 97, 98. 99 is the year we went 2-8. And they beat us the opening game of the year. And so we went 2-8 that year. We knew it was going to be a rough year. We didn't have four seniors. And then we beat them in 2000. 2001, 2002, 2003, 2004. Then in 2005, they made us drop the rivalry. They said it was too many fights, too much going on, and so the rivalry dropped. Well, there really wasn't a rivalry. In some of those years, we played them twice. We played them game one and game 10. We played them two times during the year, and we split the gate every time. So what would happen is we play them on game one, it'd be packed. Play them at game 10, they've won two games. We won nine games. Nobody shows up. And so that's kind of how it ran.
We might be playing, and you know, in the middle of the game, that's like the biggest game of the season when they before they had shut it down, and they just recently brought it back. But first game of the season, crosstown rival.
The fight broke out, but in my head, I'm thinking like, you know, where my mom's sitting at, because my mom and my grandma. And sometimes my grandfather used to come to the games too, and I'm like, you know, where are they at? Because right then, I'm like, I'm not even concerned about the game anymore. I'm concerned about where my parents at.
During that game, man, you might just be out there watching, well, in the middle of a play, and you'll look up in the stands, man, and people out there just brawling in the stands for whatever reason, I don't know, but that's just kind of the environment, you know, Hinesville was. Can't even go to a football game, man. And enjoy it without people, you know, fighting in the stands and getting in trouble.
I think Spike, in my eyes, no doubt one of the top running backs ever come through Bradwell. Like easily, just from my experience at Bradwell, he was easily one of the top running backs.
I knew Jarrell since we was kids. Our families knew each other, grew up together. And to this day, he's like a brother of mine. But like I said, I knew him, you know, before he got to Bradwell and before he accomplished those things he accomplished at Bradwell. And if you had asked me back then, that I think Jarrell Crawford would have turned out to be the running back, the football player that he was, I'd have probably told you no, just because, you know, he was real small, you know, had those real big calf muscles. And he always had that cocky frame.
Amazing athlete, very quick, very strong, smart. You want to talk about ball IQ, football IQ. He was one of the top players that I considered as a running back. Very athletic, he wasn't a tall guy, but his equilibrium and his center point of gravity made him really hard to tackle.
I just seen this short dude, and I'm like, all right, he's short, I wonder what he's gonna play. But then when I seen him in pads and seen him in the weight room, like, I'm like, damn, this little dude's strongest, you know?
Once he got to high school, man, you could tell he had been working on his game and, you know, had been hitting the gym and had been focused. I mean, he came in as a freshman and, you know, was knocking out records in the gym, getting PT as a running back, fullback on the offense. I mean, he came in, man, like, you know, just had a chip on his shoulder. And, I mean, he turned out to be great.
Great athlete as a person. As a man, we're still friends to this day. We're talking about 20 plus years of friendship right here. God, I consider one of my brothers, you know. I lean on him, he leans on me. So just on the guy as a person, outside of football, great morals, great ethic, good stand-up guy, very ethical. You know, one guy that I would I consider you, this is a guy that I want in my rabbit hole with me.
You know, you think about him going from rushing for 600 to 700 yards, playing 10 games or 11 games with a backfield full of guys who could have played, you know, Division I football, to going to his senior year rushing, you know, being a star running back, and then rushing for 1,200 plus yards in 9 games. So I think his body of work itself, you know, kind of speaks for itself, man, in my opinion, and probably a lot of other people's opinion. He's probably one of the best running backs to come out of Hinesville. And I don't think a conversation will come up if they ever ask, hey, you know, who was one of the best running backs to come out of Hinesville? His name is probably going to be in everybody's conversation, whether they're doing top 5 or top 10 and maybe even top 3.
It's a few coaches that, you know, helped me along the way. I know before he had left, I know a lot of us, you know, particularly me, Coach Watkins was a coach that always looked out for us, you know, tried to sit us down and tell us, because like I said, a lot of us were hard-headed, man. You know, we knew right from wrong, but that's not necessarily what we wanted to do all the time, you know. But you know, he managed to get his hands on a lot of us early, you know, and deliver a positive message to us. So, you know, Coach Watkins, he helped me out a lot. You know, a lot of, you know, far as going to him, talking to him, and taking things serious, you know, far as the game and whether it's the game or school or, you know, things like that.
Crazy story about Coach Akins and me. You know, he coached my uncle in the 80s at Bradwell. And I remember when I first got to Bradwell, he asked me, because he's like, hey, yo, last name's Stoddard. Do you know Anthony Stoddard? And I'm like, yeah, that's my uncle. He's like, man, that's crazy. So your uncle's great, man. Your uncle was great, man. Probably better than, I think I can't remember the guy that was playing back then, running back in the 80s. But, you know, telling him how good my uncle was and, you know, expecting the same thing out of me. And, you know, it was just one of those guys, man, that, you know, you looked up to, because Coach Akin was always, you know, out there on the field throwing them tight spirals and coaching the wide receivers up. And Coach Mock was kind of like that guy that motivated everybody, you know, always coming through there with that bald head looking like Stone Cold Steve Austin. And, you know, he always had something to pump you up, whether it was in the weight room or if you seen throughout the day, it was game day. He was always making sure that you were doing the right thing.
Love Watkins, I'll never forget him either. I don't know, I guess it's the intensity that he brought to the practices when he was there. You know, he loved you off the field, away from the practice field. But if it's practice field and you're an offensive guy, yeah, he hated you. And he told you, and he showed it, which is great because it made us come hard, you know, for that defense. But he knew his defense was going to shut it down.
Coach Ma, he made the weight room for me. He made the weight room and taking that process, you know, real serious. And he was just always a cool, genuine guy, too. I don't think I ever seen Coach Ma in a bad mood or, you know, he was just, you know, angry at times, man. Hey, look, you come in that weight room, you know, you come to practice. It was time to work, you know.
First got to Bradwell from North Carolina, I was more of a basketball player. So got out there on the football field. I was playing outside linebacker at first behind Gary Guyton, who ended up giving me a lot of guidance and a lot of help with things. But the fact of the matter is, I wasn't able to kind of beat him out of his position. So Coach Mock asked me if I wanted to put my hand on line, play DN. Started playing defensive end and made a hell of a transition from outside linebacker to DN. And had my boy JJ beside me, Brian Gaucher on the other side.
We kind of had like a small tribe for kickers. Everybody thought I was crazy for wanting to try out. But, you know, I have a soccer background. So I was like, let me try and see what I can do. And, you know, I got the job, at least kicking off. We still had somebody else doing extra points and field goals, but I kicked the ball off. So that was a great experience, you know, brought me back to my soccer days. And, got a little special boot from Coach Walsh where I had to run off the sideline and change it to my special boot and kick off. That was a little crazy, but funny. You know, I was known for that a little bit. And that was okay. Got a little nickname, Squib Master. And a funny story, my mom would make fun of me. She thought I was messing up the whole game. Like, why aren't you kicking the ball, you know, to the end zone and all that? So I'm like, that's my job. I'm a squid master, you know. I'm trying to hit the ball hard in people's hands so they fumble it, we can get it back, which happened a few times. And I actually recovered my own fumble, which I thought I just won the Super Bowl when I recovered my own fumble. I'm sure Coach Walsh remembers that. I came running back with the ball in one hand. It's like, here you go.
I know a situation where during the game I celebrated. I can't remember what I did, but I think I went like this after we scored or something. No, I think it was an interception. I went like that and we got flagged for it. Boy, Coach Walsh was hot. He made me do this all down the field during practice. While everybody else was practicing, I had to go on the field and do this.
I had a tendency on Friday nights to sometimes get very upset, you know, especially towards officials. And you know, he was my calming guy on the staff. You know, he's a great coach. You know, he's fundamentally sound, very demanding. But for me, Alex kind of kept me in check.
Coach Walsh was not having that. He wasn't going for it. Like, if somebody celebrated and we got a flag for it, he made me do that the whole practice, literally, like this. So that was just... that was probably one of my moments where I was like, I ain't celebrating again. And I didn't even get the interception. I just had a good block, and I just got excited. I mean, it happens to me.
Coach Cockrell showed up at my house and kind of sort of grabbed me out my house and told me to come with him. And he told me what I got to lose. But he don't like it, he'll bring me back to my home, and we'll get it done that way. So on this particular day, I rode in the truck with him and then came to practice. And that day, my sophomore year, I fell back in love with football. And then me and Coach Watkins, we talked about it. And I told him, you know, I just don't have a way. At this point, I didn't have a way to practice and back home. So Coach Watkins decided to drive me back and forth from home, from practice and home, for football practice.
Glenn was a pretty good football team. We were still trying to find ourselves. You know, we wasn't world beaters.
They ran, a wing T offense just like a lot of other teams did. But when you looked across at their offensive line, you looked at their tight end, you looked at their running backs, that they were not your average typical high schooler. I mean, they were a lot larger, and they probably were one of the more physical teams we faced that year.
We knew he was a big running back, wasn't the fastest, but super strong. Tight end, big cat. They didn't really throw the ball too much to him, but you know, he was there to kind of give people some issues.
Akeem Brown, Kwame Brown's brother, the running back. He was like 6'4", probably like 220, 230. Might be exaggerating slightly, but probably not. He was pretty big. But I remember him doing choo-choo, choo-choo all night long. And it was just aggravating the whole defense all night long. We was just trying to tag him.
Big play on the sideline from the hook and lateral. Threw it to the receiver, pitched it off to Akeem Brown. He took off down the sideline on this Coach Miller, and he gave us hell about that one.
I don't know what the play was, but he was the ball carrier and took it to the house.
He's a big dude. You know what I'm saying? And he was just tiptoeing. He wasn't even running full speed. He was just tiptoeing in the hole. And he was just big and just stiff on people. And that was really his game. I mean, he didn't really have, like, no skill to me.
What was really good, though, is when we had an opportunity to bow our necks. That's a huge win.
Offense, man, they were just doing their thing, you know what I'm saying? They were just killing it.
The defense then huddled up, and it became, we gotta stop them. They're gonna get the ball back. We have got to stop them. If we don't stop them, this loss is on us.
Talking trash, was in the field talking trash.
Their quarterback had thrown a long pass, kind of stopped the clock. Instead of spiking the ball, he took a knee. And that's the only thing that probably saved them from scoring on us and probably beating us that game. So, sometimes you got to have a little luck when you play some of these teams. And Glenn's a hard place to win.
We stopped them. We stopped them on fourth down. Clock ran out, and they didn't do anything. We left with a W.
My junior year, you know what I'm saying, I was still behind, like, Mike McCampbell. And, you know, I was patiently waiting my turn. But I remember 2003 Effingham game. I don't know what reason Mike McCampbell didn't play that game. I can't remember, but I started that game. I remember we watched film against the Effingham squad, and they running back looked like a beast. I remember they had that running back, I forget his name, and they had a fullback. Fullback was huge. And was watching film on him, and I was like, oh man, this is what I gotta go against my first start. I was in the backfield like almost every play. The running back didn't even really have a lot of yards. I always remember, you know, like some of the great players I played with, like Gary Guyton, played with Allen Brunson.
One of the best games I ever had in high school was 2003. We played Jig in high school. Jiggs was on the goal line, about to score. We have a great goal line stand with Mr. Charles Crosley. He hits the guy, ball squirts out, bam. I come pick the ball up for a scoop and score. I scoop the ball up and I go 98 yards with a crowd, with a host of Tigers, my friends. We just run all the way down the field. And I scored 3 touchdowns in one night on defense. I never seen it happen. I never heard anything like this, but it was something amazing for me. It was a great day, great night in 2003 that year. And then I guess the cherry on top was I was the homecoming king for that night. That was the best game I ever had at any level of my career.
Came out of that game just so pumped up. Our momentum was high. You know, nobody could have thought what we were going to do coming out of that tunnel, coming out of that locker room, you know, and stepping on that field. If you'd have said, hey, y'all guys are going to put up 50-some points in the first quarter and you won't play for the rest of the game, probably would have laughed at you, you know. But, you know, lo and behold, we came out first quarter and it just seemed like we was clicking on all cylinders, you know. Touchdown here, touchdown there, defense scoring, offense scoring, kickoff return, punt returns. It seemed like we played a perfect game in a quarter. You know, we probably could have put up 100 points that game easily, but, I mean, it solidified ourselves in the record books probably, but, you know, Coach Walsh wasn't one of those guys that felt like he needed to prove a point.
Well,
kind of stuck with us all year. And when we got to that game, when we got to the Groves game, we beat it in their heads that this Jonathan Armstrong was not going to run all over us.
They had beat us so bad that year before, we knew that we was going to come in and try to return that favor.
Had a cat named Clark that had a real good tackle and a guard. I think, if I'm not mistaken, Gaucher had the tackle. He was going against the tackle all game, and I was going against the guard.
And that guy was a really good back.
It was just a statement game, you know. That particular game, that geared us up for going into the Camden game. But we wanted to return that favor. They felt like they still was a better team than us because of what they did the year before. But what I remember very good is our defense stepping up in a big way, you know. A lot of those guys took the game in 2003 very personal, especially when you got a running back that run for 275 yards on you. You know, I leave a sour taste in your mouth.
2004, man, we already had that built up. Like, man, it's payback after what they did to us last year. And then we had to come out and we had to show them what's up.
Shout out KG, man. We used to do something real. I don't want to say it was stupid at the time, but you know, at that time we had this little thing going on, man. Everybody put their fists. Put their fists in the air and do this right here. I guess that, you know, that was symbolizing like, hey man, you can get this work.
And we stepped up to the challenge that game.
That was just my mentality. I was like, I'm the man now. And I was coming through the line, I was going through the line untouched.
the kids took it to heart. And I mean, and they played physical. And every time they hit him, they said, look at my number. I'm going to be right back again and hit you again. And by the end of the game, I don't think he warned anymore.
The game against Camden County, it brings up a lot of memories. But Camden County, I mean, leading up to it, the hype was crazy. I mean, we were 9-0. They were 9-0. I believe we were ranked number 9 in the state.
I don't remember how many people it was, but I know we ended up having to make makeshift bleachers on both sides of the end zones in order to fit more people.
Man, you could look over to the visitor side, and our visitor side was just as big as the home side. It was actually the same size, and it was packed to the top too. You know, the sidewalks behind the goalposts. It was just packed, man. It felt like a college environment.
I was wearing a single ear headset, and I had to put my hand over my other ear to be able to hear the coaches talk to me on the headset. That's how loud it was. I know some of the players would come off the field and they said, Coach, they can't hear the calls. It's so loud. And we never had to experience that before.
This was a game that was gonna determine the number one seed for our region. And I do remember it was a packed stadium. Kind of a standing room only. And I definitely know that it was a game where anybody that was at that stadium that night got to enjoy a great high school football game.
It was definitely something different going to this game this year. You didn't hear any of that. The coaches was, focused. Every play was just, hey, you missed a block, or hey, you missed this, or just everything was just turned up a notch. And you could tell that everybody believed we had a chance. And even in the locker room, even during the game, when we kind of met adversity, everybody still was like, hey, we're going to win this game. A lot of that stuff came from the summertime. That work we put in that summer, a lot of us went down to Camden County, completed a weightlifting competition, and came back with some gold medals. If I recall, I know myself, Jarrell Crawford, Spike, JJ McWhiller, we all came back with the gold medals in our weight class. That meant a lot to us. Like finally beating Camden County is something. They got all the nice equipment. They got all the best equipment. They got the nice uniforms. They got all this sponsorship stuff. They just won a national, they won a state championship. They ranked in the top teams in the nation. And it was just, it was always something with Camden County, and it was just that year we felt like we had a chance. Because we had a lot of doubters, high school kids that, been at Bradwell all the years and never seen us beat Camden. They was there when we used to get beat by 30 and 25 points without even scoring. And, so of course, we had reason to be doubted. But, if you played with us that year, you were senior on that team. There was one thing you wanted more than anything was probably to beat Camden County your last game. And I know for myself, I was just super focused going into that game. We did everything the same as we always did, and I felt like we can compete with anybody.
That week, it was as serious can get. Two 9-0 teams, two heavyweights. There was talks of ESPN coming out there, other news cameras, local news, and just all kind of national news too. I mean, this was for a region title of Region 3-5A. And no one expected any – Camden County didn't expect any competition from Bradwell Institute. We were 9-0, right? And we've went through some hard battles. But the fact is they rolled through our region.
Coach Miller gave the offense the player's name from Camden and taped it, on their helmets because he wanted us to see and remember who we was going to be going against. And, I think that week in practice, man, we was all focused. Everybody was focused. You know what I'm saying? With no playing around, everybody came to practice that day. We was listening, we was watching film. It was a good week, and I even think the week before that too.
But my biggest memories of that game is just the crowd, just the atmosphere. I remember looking over at Vince one time and just we both looked at each other like, man, are we really in a game like this right now? It was just, emotions, man, just through the roof. Those are my biggest memories. Gauthier, the rest of the D-line, the linebackers. I remember Charles Crosley had an incredible game.
We worked hard that week. We worked really hard that week, from film study to going over cars, scouting reports. And what's funny about the scouting report was they ran the same six plays we ran. There was nothing fancy. They would throw in a couple of wrinkles here, and those wrinkles were not really true wrinkles. They weren't doing any halfback passes or anything like that. We knew what was coming, and they knew what was coming. So it boils down to it being, this is a heavyweight fight. I mean, we're not ducking and dodging. We're going and throwing haymakers, and let's see who's going to come out.
The story unfolds before your eyes, now you see why success is the route. Without a doubt, since we was knee high, we win you out. Like an old pair of Levi's, we sacrifice our time and our summers. Our blood, sweat, and tears accumulated, now we out here doing wonders. No wondering why, just wide eyes in amazement. We blazing a trail off of this motto we was raised
with. Went right down and scored, and lo and behold, we missed the extra. Our dreams formulated, and I said, oh my God, we slept. I missed the extra. Dominating competition to the death, bleeding blue and gold. Nothing left, we rep. Be our flight. Apex predators, slaying competitors, hunger and bitterness, staying two steps ahead of your games and checkers was never us. Our strategies coincided with conquer and divide. No defeat, the weakest link, your talk is cheap. We you near us, your ways we get the seat. Rest in peace, we some killers. We'll knock you out your cleats, we some beasts. Can you feel us? What you think about dodging a human bullet? Then try us, linebackers hitting harder than subwoofers. Inspired by the masses who motivated and pushed us. Admired by detractors who mastered being onlookers. This bond took us beyond limits, never set. We rebels with a cause for cause, we live in with regrets. So place your bets against all odds, we won't fold out. We manipulate our cause, then we go all out. The doubt was only real as innocent fears. We conquer Satan, now we thrown it while just conquer for years. We had lost Jerome Howard in the Camden game, and we had to shuffle some people around in the secondary, and I didn't know how key Jerome Howard was at free safety until you miss someone. When someone performs and does their job, and you don't see him make great plays, but you just see the play being made, and then getting the secondary lined up and knowing where to line up and knowing what to recognize. When he got hurt, we had to start shuffling people around, and I think that kind of hurt us a little bit in the secondary. But, that's the thing you have to do. You have to prepare for that.
It was a tough game. I'm not going to lie, tough game. They had a strong D-line, strong O-line.
When Houston County comes to us, they had a D1 football player going to Georgia, supposed to be a real big guy, and we looked at film and said, he don't look that big. They're not that big. What it was, their whole defense was that big. It made him look average, and so they were humongous.
That week, we had a lot of dynamics going on during practice. So it was a sense that, on Monday, it was a little bit of a lull because everybody was still a little, tainted off that loss that we just had.
I ended up playing DN and tight end that game because I had to block Kyle.
Coach Walsh was so conservative, and, I felt like we had worked on so much offense that week prior, and the weeks prior to that, that we could have put in. And we put in offenses, to combat their size, because they were a much bigger team. We knew we couldn't just blow those guys off the ball and run down their throats downhill. We knew we had to spread them out. And, beat them with our speed. Because, if you look at any newspaper clipping up, you know, coming to that game, all they were talking about is Bradwell speed. And then coming to that game, you know, we go back to, you know, what we do best is run that wing T offense, that trap, that downhill with Daniel Fleming, and it wasn't working. You know, we had a guy on our offensive line that was 120 pounds, you know, and you line him up against guys that are 200 plus pounds, we're not playing in, you know, the region 3, 5A anymore. You know what I'm saying? We're playing against teams from different regions and they're stacked on the front.
Also remember having to dive the second half, dive into the D lineman's feet, which I don't know if it was the best move or not for us as a team. Felt like it kind of handicapped us as D linemen, and it kind of blocked the you know, avenue for our linebackers.
John was giving me Pedialyte. Like almost after like each series, I go to the sideline. And I already got a fever. I take my helmet off and I'm hot. Got a cold towel around my head. And John comes to Pedialyte, drink it, start throwing it up, yakking. Then I had to go back in the game. Go back in the game and literally I was off. I was getting blown off the line. Tackles was pulling. Like I was getting blown out. I wasn't doing nothing that whole game. I was weak. I was trying to hold on to people and getting drugged at games.
And they beat us. Wish we'd turn back the hands of time, but we can't.
It was a major letdown. It was a major letdown. I truly regret not putting the work that week. Because it's another instance of, you know, yeah, Camden beat us, but we were better than Houston County.
Anybody can win on any given night. And, you know, having the opportunity 11 times to play and come out ahead 9 of those 11, that's pretty good. You know, would we have liked to go further in the postseason? Sure. You know, who would? But when it's all said and done, you know, when you get to the best 32 teams in the state, that's pretty good. You know, and at the time, there was like 595 schools in the state. So, you know, what we were able to accomplish in 2004 definitely was special.
The only thing I can tell you about the 04 season is that when that class graduated, we were senior laden that year, really senior laden. In the 05 season, we only had 2 returning guys on defense, and I think only like 1 or 2 returning guys on offense. So it became a building process after that. So we had, you know, we had a real good year. We'd had a bunch of good years in a row. But that right there was kind of the climax. That 04 season was kind of like, I don't call it the end of the golden age, but there was a run that we went through that we were winning seven or more ball games a year. We were going to state playoffs and doing that kind of thing. And so from that point on, we kind of went kind of mediocre until we had a good year in 08. All them freshmen that played on the 04 team were then seniors on the 08 team. And so we had a good year in 08. So I kind of, you know, we kind of groomed those kids that were freshmen in the 04 season for the 08 season. But we had to go through growing pains in 5, 6, and 7 to get to that point.
It's not just about the game. You know, it's about developing young people into becoming productive people. And you know, that was probably one of the biggest things that, you know, when you look back on coaches that were part of my career as a head coach, I was very fortunate to have good people. Not just good football coaches, but good people.
After our senior year, man, and, you know, even before our senior year, I think Arcel started going through a lot of different things, and, you know, life started catching up with him. And, you know, unfortunately, he was one of those guys that kind of just got caught up in what we call it a trap, you know. And that's just, you know, that's just your circumstances that you can't seem to shape. You know what I mean? I could have been one of those guys that got caught up in the same system. Like I said, I kind of grew up, you know, in a worse situation than I would say Arcel did. But the people I surrounded myself with, you know, after high school, you know, was people that kind of motivated me to do better. And I think for Arcel, man, a lot of things that happened, you know, once he got done with football, and he probably wasn't surrounding himself with the best of people, that kind of led to him getting himself involved in a lot of different things that kind of, you know, ruined opportunities for him. You know, he's just kind of like one of those guys, and he's probably that story that you hear about, like, hey, don't mess up, or don't be like this, or don't be like that guy. But you know, Arcel is one of those people, again, that, you know, when they say one of the best players, you know, if he wasn't around, somebody's going to remind you that, hey, you're forgetting about Arcel, or did you ever know who Arcel McCullum was, or, you know, whatever the case was. Because, like I said, the kid was a special talent, man, and he could play either side of the ball, or, you know, wherever you want to play. I mean, that speed, that ability to play, he was a smart football player, savvy, you know, just had that will, wanted to win, just determined kid, man. I can remember some games, and we would come in the huddle, and I said, look at you like, man, I got it. You know, don't worry about it. We're going to win this game. And you believe him because he did it time in and time out. I mean, when you go from playing running back your entire career to your senior year, you know, when all the chips on the line, you go to position a quarterback and don't think twice about it. And then, you know, you bring your team to a top 10 ranking and, you know, within 2 points of beating the number one team in the nation. You know, that just kind of speaks volumes of his character, man, on the football field and his will to win. So it definitely was a privilege playing with Arcel. In my opinion, once again, you know, he's one of them guys that you can't not name when you say one of the elite players to ever come through Bradwell. And I say that, like, you know, with no doubt in my mind.
I'm just playing. I'm gonna laugh. Hey, we're gonna keep it rolling. No, keep it rolling.
But it was frowned upon when I came. You know, I live in the same hood as Joe, Tim Modavine and all them, and they would play basketball every day with football outside. It's like soccer, huh? So, you know, football was.
Daniel Fleming.
Yeah.
Right, I ain't ready? Gonna forget Daniel. Are you gonna get Daniel?
I know we talked about Brunswick before when you kicked the hole in the locker, yeah, in 2003.
Come in! Georgia Military College. Look at it. Look at it. Huh? I mean, that's the... Are we still doing this?
Now, it's Texas to you. This is Texas pool to you. We just got a Y following. A Y following you, okay? This is Texas to the line. Here we go.
Get that feeling.
Oh God. I said some other one, why I can't remember now.